Therese texted me. Hush. Questions, just text me. I'm gonna go sit over there. Flush the cord.
Thank you.
Okay, members of the group.
Yeah.
Thank you.
5 years.
Councilmember Terry Callahan. Councilmember Richard Lewis. And Councilmember Ronda Alton. So we just introduced council members and elected officials. Nothing happens when we go to CPRA and we meet with you guys behind the scenes without our council's involvement and support. And they push us to make sure that we're doing the right things for the citizens of Sigur County. So, council members, thank you for being here today. Our assessor, Jay Lynn Turner. Thank you all for being here today. To start the meeting today, I just wanted to just say a few words that are very short, Mr. Chairman. You got the white room here, the line stop, please feel free to take one with you today. I know the sheriff's already got two in his pocket. He's talking about it. I got a deputy waiting for him at the door. You see on the screen behind us, we've got the white boot. Chip stole the white boot from the donut coffee deal back there. But you know, it's a symbol of our community, the fisheries being centered on, which is our culture, which is our heritage. And forgive us here in St. Paul Parish if we look to the negative impacts of any project that CPRA puts forward. It's important to us, it's important that we get it right, because it means so much to all the communities in coastal Louisiana. So when we were going to have this meeting a few years ago, we prepared a video which we planned on putting a commercial together to point out exactly that everything that we do here, when we look at mitigation factors, and I know Bill, you guys, and Platters just went through the process.
We are constantly doing that.
So we're going to wait. Yeah.
But you've seen us in the news. Our biggest headlines came from unfortunate events. But that's not who we are. That's what helped build our character and faith. We are a passionate, hardworking coastal community. We work every day despite hardships and obstacles that are placed in front of us. We are resilient. We put fruit on your table and preserve our heritage. We are not known for who we are. We hope to be known for what we do. We are not celebrating, but we are incredible. And we do incredible things. We are a working coast. We gotta get it right.
So that's a commercial that we worked on with Ella Chalmette and Kate Tomasio. So, and what I wanted to say before we started was, you know, when we go through the EIS process for the version of the barataria side, we look at that $360 million mitigation to make sure that actually negates the negative impacts that project will have. And we know we're going to be dealing with that here in San Diego. And we're going to work with CPRA, we're going to be part of the EIS process to make sure that our culture and heritage continues. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Here's a few pictures. The construction wind monitoring is approximately $23 million total for these for this Quiver project. In these images, we'll see the shoreline protection, which are particularly in concrete mats. On the right hand side at the top, that's the crane lowering those mats onto the containment deck that was constructed. And at the bottom, you'll see what they look like after they've been there for a little while. Moving on to the next project, we have the Golden Triangle Restoration Project. This is a NERDA project. It was funded by NERDA for construction. It was funded by the Restore Act for E&D. It was going to create approximately 700 acres of marsh. And it is located in St. Bernard Parish, over there by Lake Warren. Here's a map of the project area. You can see the fill cells on the left there in purple. All of the red are rush releases, just in case you're curious about all of that. And so we avoided those as best we could in accessing from the bar area to whatever there is just south of Shift Pass. This project is currently under construction. This is the cost breakdown of the engineering design for almost $5 million and construction at approximately $50 million. All three fill cells have received some fill at this time, and we are still under construction. Moving on to the Lake Warren Restoration Project. This is another funded project. This is increment one of this phase of the project. There are other increments to come. It's looking to restore basically the rim of Lake Warren and provide some protection to all the communities out there that provide us with all the living and seafood we get. For this project, it's just over $100 million, and we're going to create almost 2,800 acres of marsh. As you can see, we're from left to right, we're moving with that 7 fill cells. Our area is right there anymore, and it's a large scale of project. It goes from Shell Beach all the way over to Hogan, pretty much, and Bayou Lutheran. So we're looking forward to getting this one done. And just as kind of a scale, NCA2 right there is 855 acres alone, which, if you remember, the project I just mentioned was almost 700 acres. So just to give you a scale of the size of this project and the size of the field area we're talking about, which is over here. As of now, this is the largest by acreage project that CPRA has ever undertaken. And this is just a quick flyover that's looking out of the warm flying back over some of the broken marsh we're looking to restore. And that's the rock shoreline of the previous project that was constructed to protect the shoreline. Just to give you an idea of where we're going to get some material and hopefully get that marsh back up and healthy again. And here is some aerial images of the containment. If you remember that image, we're looking south towards Hope Jail. The small one on the left is NCA4. The one in front and center is NCA3. You can see the marsh buddies cabins and that there. You can see a piece of NCAT that 855 acres of marsh before. And here is, these are two waterfowl habitat areas. We thought it was something different than ponds, but they're for restoring some habitat to allow the migratory birds to have a place to go. Since we're supposedly building all the land back, we need some moving water to allow the habitat to continue and just some more containment there. This is the story coming out. We did have some dredging in MCA4 again. And this is an engineering image of MCA4. This is about 3.5 years after they were replacing the water, this is what they look like, and this picture was taken in 2017. This is the same project with the jacks structures, same pattern. And moving on to the barricade base of marsh creek and which project expansion has improved. Utilizing material rest in Mississippi River, pumping it over to create rich habitat and a lot of marsh. Approximately 1,500 acres of marsh, 138 rich, and we're using just over 10 million cubic yards of material to create this project. The project is approximately 7 miles long, so from the beginning where the hill lines and fence all the way over to the left, and that's approximately 7 miles. It's a very project. Construction is approximately $87 million. The E&D is approximately $5 million. ROM is approximately $5 million as well. Some of that ROM is going to fund some planting for the original ridge here this winter. We're going to plant some This is the best way to start off the container type if you work with four soils. It allows you to put a lot down all at once and build that nice base that you're all sitting with in that finish. They let that base harden and then you come back and put it on material and shape it. In this image, so on the top left, you can see at the very bottom left corner of that image, that's one of those areas they touched up along that corridor, and then you're progressing out towards the area waterway. And then on the right top, you can see the containment. That large polygon in the middle is meant to be left open as an underwater area. And then at the bottom, you see the bridge on the river. And just looking back towards the project, it's such a long distance you can't really see the project very well based on the imagery. But it's, the pipeline is essentially 10 miles long for this project.
All right, thank you for that, Barry. And personal thanks to you and Barry and the Department of Oil and Steel staff is one of the individuals that are making sure that this project is being done in the right in the that concludes our presentation. I appreciate everybody's attention. Any questions, of course, we'll start to have an answer to your questions. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Terry and Brandon. Before I open it up to the members for questions, I hope every person here today pay close attention to that presentation because there is an incredible amount of work that is taking place in this area, both in St. Bernard Parish and Blackmans Parish. And more often times than not, members, we tend to get caught up in the diversion discussion. And every single project that Barry and Drew just talked about and highlighted in this area is a dredging project, it's a shoreline protection project, it's a living shoreline project where we're either using a concrete aggregate or a concrete type structure, or we are dredging. And that is going to continue. If you listen to what Barry just said, largest ridge restoration project for the state, largest marsh creation project for the state, largest restoration project by a federal agency, taking place in St. Bernard and Blackmans Parish. And so while we tend to get caught up in back and forth on whether such diversions are going to work or not, there is a tremendous amount of collaboration that takes place with this guy and members of the Parish Council and the oyster industry outside a set of diversions. And I think that's important for every person here to recognize. And as I tell the governor at every cabinet meeting, you have got to get down to St. Bernard and start talking about all of these projects that we are building besides seven diversions. Because I think these are tremendous success stories of how we are working collaboratively with St. Bernard and Blackmans Parish. So I hope everybody just would reflect on that a little bit today. Any questions for Bryn or Eric on implementation of the
Okay, do it well.
So there were two recent supplemental bills that have passed. One is the Disaster Relief Supplemental Appropriations Act for HRSA, which was signed into law in 2021. And the other is the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law, which was previously known as IJA, or the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, which was signed into law in November. Under HRSA, New Orleans was allocated just under $2 billion, and under the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law, just under $1 billion. So looking there at this slide, you can see the breakdown of the business lines that funding is going under. For HRSA, a large chunk of that, just under $2 billion, was in the construction account, $1.5 billion, and then another large chunk in the Mississippi River tributary account at just under $400 million. The remaining dollars were allocated to the investigations, cap, operations and maintenance, and SEC programs. Under bipartisan infrastructure law, again, similarly, a large chunk of that money was in the construction and the R&T accounts at just under $800 million. And then the remaining balance in the operations and maintenance accounts. So looking at that, it's a bunch of numbers and accounts that probably doesn't mean much to you. So the next slide, we'll look at some specific projects so you can see where that's the dollars. So this slide gives an overview of some key projects that were funded under these supplemental appropriations. Now, I do want to point out these are not, this is not an all-inclusive list. There are other projects, but these are ones that I picked out. Pretty large funding source that would be of interest to the board. Looking at the slide and the legend there at the bottom left, you can see the type of business line, which is color-coded, with the orange representing the investigation and design account, the green the Mississippi River tributaries, and the blue the construction account. So looking at these particular projects, and again, these aren't all projects, just some ones of interest. Starting with the investigations in orange, $3 million for the flood risk management study, which will look at alternatives
state.
That's correct.
Correct. So the $3 million, I'm sorry if I already did this, $3 million is to look at for the long term sustainability plan for Red Apple.
That's correct. We currently got $120 million, moving forward with the first phase of that work, and we'll be implementing second phases for Rock and the other clay core here later this year. That's separate from the seven. This $3 million will be if we need to build a bigger sacrifice or high grade rock system.
And the MRT portion of this is going to be handled where that look?
Vicksburg will do about half of the MRT. And that's just for the MR. It's that lot based work will still be handled by as well.
I think there's been a lot of discussions on how that money for the HLI is going to be used. I know that there was some specific things mentioned in the federal legislation that relates to the HLI, but there's been a lot of questions from stakeholder groups and within the basin on ideas, concepts that they'd like for the board to look at. And so there's, once we get the clarity or the guidance on all of that, I think it would be very helpful for the board to end up. I don't know if you've got any clarity at this time.
So. I don't respond yet. Yeah, we can start the next board meeting.
Okay, thank you. Any questions? Okay, wow. Mr. Poles.
What's the timing on the tangible hope project?
That is another 3-year effort. We're getting ready to sign that. Cost share for the year, I'd say by the end of the year. So you've got another 3-year effort until that gets completed and achieved.
So I know you're aware of this, but I want to make sure that we're exchanging information between the watershed initiative and the world with the modeling that DOD is doing already on the river and just make sure that it's coordinating this with the gap.
Yeah, correct. We're asking you all. We're utilizing the information to do this. Yeah, Pat, we're in communication with the various consultants coordinating that.
I'm sorry.
Thank you, Chairman. So you asked three more questions already, so we'll not go into that. But next, for the studies and the design, so the time frame for all of those four of these key projects that you have referenced on this slide here, so that timeline has already started?
No, the timeline will start once we sign the agreement. And we'll sign it as SESA money.
By when?
The end of the year.
The year. Okay. And the the time frame for those, like you said, is 3 years. Is there a way with all the data that we have on all these projects? Is there a way to condense that? I mean, time is of the essence in all of our areas. So.
Yeah, I agree. There is a way to advise. I don't want to tell you it's going to be a year. But an outstanding standard study is 3 years. Unfortunately, that does take a long time. That is what our standard is. But like I said, in roughly 9 months, that's when we'll know what the recommendation is going to be. So then we can start with that alternate design. It won't hold up any construction that we're doing right now because we'll know what the recommendation will be in roughly 9 months.
Okay.
All right, Mr. Murphy.
Thank you, Jim. In the 8 million and up of our area project and design, you mentioned a septic gate. Where is the septic gate proposed to be located?
I would have to look at it back with you. I'm not sure exactly where that is, but that was one of the notes that I had, but I'd have to get back with you.
Will you please let us?
Yes, sir.
Let's move on.
One of the things that Chairman referred to was when this work gets chopped out together in shirts. Think about Arkansas, which is still being handled by New Orleans district. And from time to time, things come up, and there's the non-federal sponsor is able to have a meeting come together very quickly. We had it earlier this week to work through some issues. And I just fear that with Barataria, which is another one that's in our district, you're going to lose some of that ability to have a quick conversation with the non-federal sponsors, like we've had when we're working with the New Orleans district, and we're instead dealing with the district in St. Paul, Minnesota. So I understand that New Orleans generally marched south of mine, but those folks didn't think, right? The water's coming down, we just got to pull it down. So understanding a storm surge protection levee in St. Paul, Minnesota, has got to be a challenge. And so what I would say is instead of us just waiting to see if it's working, that there's got to be created some opportunities for us to be convinced that they understand the nitty-gritty of the land and what we're facing in this area.
Questions for Mr. Sims? Just looking at that map, Nick, and I just jotted down a few notes. So just think about this for a second. New Orleans to Venice, the hurricane protection system around Greater New Orleans, Upper Barataria, West Shore, La Rosa to Golden Meadow, Morganza to the Gulf, South Central, what you don't see on there is St. Anthony, which we're very close to, hopefully, finalizing the line there. And then Tangible. So just think about the opportunity that is in front of us to have large portions from South Central and Southeast Louisiana behind some sort of risk reduction system. And I think that's what we always been working for us. And so just looking at that is just an incredible opportunity that I think we need to take full advantage of. And then even moving to Southwest Louisiana, the fact that Southwest Coastal now is close to $300 million, it's just incredible news. So, full throttle. So thank you for being here. Mr. Sims.
No problem, thank you all.
All right, members, let's move on to our standing agenda item for the last few meetings, which is a federal congressional update from Mr. McMillan, who I'm commonly referred to as Delia in the office. Ranking member Inhofe, Senator
big provision in the RISE Act, the Grease Act, to interview capacity. So we're pushing, but any continual outreach you can do to the delegations, the campus, and front burner, I believe it is for most of them, would be most appreciated. And hopefully we have a tremendous Christmas all around. But that's the end of my presentation, and happy to answer some questions.
CPRA, from our delegation, and before when all this gets settled, we hope we can get the word quickly on that mitigation effort for the district. Which is
it's a very important issue as how the state as a whole is approaching resilience in the various things. To have a role that Charles will give us an update on that. So,
thank you, Chip.
Very much for that discussion. Couldn't agree more. I want to do two things today. And one is obviously just to give you an update on some progress reports we have from 12 different state agencies, which I think is really exciting. And then just talk kind of like what Chip's saying, like what does this look like for the long term? We're taking some early steps here with this initiative we've been doing the last couple of years. So, what does this look like? First, I want to start by just thanking my colleagues over at the Center for Planning Excellence, Jeanette Jamie, and they're extremely helpful with my team on this. I just want to thank them. And I also want to thank the resilience coordinators. We've got people in every state agency who've been working on this with us. And several on the board, like Joey Grove and Mike Nitz and Bill Williamson, and Pat Forbes has been on our steering committee that we engaged as care and actually took as well the steering committee that we engaged on in the early stages of this project. And I just want to start by just kind of telling you one of the biggest takeaways that we have about working with all these different state agencies. It's been really great to see just how amazing the public service that we have in the state of Louisiana are. When disasters strike, they are not immune to the impacts themselves, and yet they're picking up and going to work. They're trying to get these programs up and running again, trying to get the most money they can from the federal government for recovery. And they're doing that and just generally helping the neighbors. Privilege to kind of work with them and see this work unfold as we've gone over this last 2 years that have been really dramatic coming to the state. Just in background, just two background slides. But what are we talking about when we're talking about resilience? I mean, first, the history of this kind of does go back to 2017 National Plan. You start seeing the future with action maps and the change that we're still going to see on the coast. A year later, the government called the whole cabinet together and said, how are we going to work on this together in 2018? And then followed the executive order in 2020. But it really does, like Chip said at the beginning, it really does line up the federal approach that we're seeing. And it puts us in the main part of the conversation. So really, how do we do this across all government and not just CPRA, which is our first authority to have this? And I would say, too, that the state would kind of approach this at a very maximum difficulty level. A lot of states are really thinking about assets, we're thinking about infrastructure kinds of impacts. We're trying to think beyond that, that's what this five pieces showing up there. And a lot of states are thinking about one type of hazard, like flooding or wildfires. So we're trying to think first about all the different things that are changing along the coast, and then we're going to think about how to stay five after that. All the literature and just lived experience will tell you that resilience isn't just one thing, it's all these different things that you see on this. So everybody knows that you don't pay for roads, but all your neighbors move away, you drive out, get the doctor, no jobs, the environment's polluted. You don't have those same communities, and that's what we're kind of building in. These other infrastructures are always going to be important. We want to actually make sure we're not thinking about the people side, the economic side, the environmental side as we're building this out. The other thing that's important in terms of what we're doing is just how we're doing it. So on the left side of the slide, we've got these four principles. Information, integration, participation, innovation. And these are good ways to think about adaptation, yes, but it's also just kind of good ways to think about it. So it's about who you talk to, you utilizing science and data to make your own decisions. This is a model that can be applied to not just physical adaptation, but maybe your project that's going to be competitive or IJA or IRO, one of these other funding streams. So I took both these things that we want to think about. How we're doing this, what we're doing, we're hoping to kind of change the culture so that resilience is something, adaptation is something we're kind of infusing in everything that we do, and it's not just a one-time funding opportunity or a particular disaster opportunity, but the way we're trying to think about how to do this work like I mentioned, you know, structure created these zones coordinators for our state agency. And I just want to spend 1 second on that before I get to kind of the findings from the agencies. I just think it's been a really good structure and something that other states have seen as well. That doesn't make sense, maybe we should look at too. It gives us a forum to talk across government, similar to boards and some of those forums, so it gives another way to exchange information, have conversations about things. It gives us access to data and experts in different departments, but also these pictures from the AC Gallup, for example, coordinators who brought in Dr. Christian Mankowski from CPRA, who's in the master plan team. She's able to share the master plan viewer, how it's going to change the 23 plan, and the idea there is we want other agencies to think about the data that's available from CPRA. Especially looking at the future and how we can think about that as the major response in their world. So the last step in the process we went through was for the agencies to kind of complete a proposal of life adaptation plan, as well as four questions on it. Okay, what is your role in the state responding to this problem? How is the problem affecting you? Number three, what is the adaptation that you can institute or start investigating? Solve those problems, and then finally, how, if we can be able to do that, how does that support what's going to go to the national organization? So, as I said, we have 12 state agencies that potentially have a really good cross section of all the different types of things that government does and all the different ways that this coastal crisis is impacting state agencies. And I would say that the biggest takeaway is that every state agency that we've been in contact with has had a key mission affected directly by the changes happening on the coast. So there's no evidence to this. Just to draw some couple of examples from agencies who aren't on this board, just to kind of drive that point home. We have the Department of Children and Family Services, whose mission is to work to keep children safe, helping individuals and families become self-sufficient, provide safe refuge during disasters. And they point out that, you know, as disasters expand the reach of coastal land losses eroding, impact on children and individuals and families is more at risk. A greater number of larger population areas are going to be at risk. So this is how those are things are really directly hitting up with them. The Department of Revenue, obviously, they collect taxes from different individuals, businesses, corporations. And as these disasters happen, as coastal change happens for them, it gets harder and more inefficient to collect state tax revenues. And so, you know, reduced state revenues go down, this budget cuts for all of them, not just coastal. So it's providing key services across the entire state does mean that even that comes back to coastal issues. So on the vulnerability side, I should do a couple quick examples. We saw that, as I mentioned, you know, there are risks to property, infrastructure, and assets spread from one side of the state all the way to the other. And at every state agency. So this is obviously a financial burden for the state, but it also directly affects the ability to do our jobs and deliver services to people and care about the issues. And so I don't want you to think just about office buildings full of white-collar workers, but I want you to think about public health units, job centers, free store facilities for schooling programs, cultural and historic sites, all this critical infrastructure. So the picture of what I showed, some roadways that are affected by flooding, and then also, of course, housing. So state agencies help deliver housing, especially rural housing, all across the state. And this Louisiana Housing Corporation said that, you know, the time of construction, we build houses in places that weren't considered high risk, and now that's changed. And so that's just another example of how this is happening. Of course, even if your building doesn't flood, disasters make it harder to serve these health and services agencies that really are working with people who are vulnerable, not just because of where they live, because of the coast gave them, but they're vulnerable because of their economic status and their health, age, and all these different things, and serving them is so important to such a key mission of government. We've got to make sure they're not like that as well. So we also have certain programs that aren't even kicked off until a disaster hits, and these state agencies will have to do their own job. Staff is super critical response jobs and programs as well, with often innovation and additional resources. The good news is there are a lot of adaptation options that have been identified that people are looking at. make sure it's a full hazard complex that's done by the SDP in New Orleans. It also was the pathway to the solar panels on the roof. We've got really efficient appliances all throughout the departments. And so they're able to run the commercials on battery power as the grid will not stay like the other on the social services side, the Children's Family Services is piloting a program in Lafayette called No Wrong Door. It's basically trying to look at how do you turn from a paradigm where individuals that suffer from disasters have to find their way to a system of different programs and different things available from government and pull down services that they think they qualify for. How do you switch that and make them into a push service where all the agencies are working together and pushing things down? Just one more example is the body culture collaborative, which is something that happened out of the Louisiana cultural office. They're in constant conversation about the cultural impacts of all this coastal change. As people move, as sites are eroded away, how do we maintain culture and preservation throughout the conversation? So these are all really good things. The challenge we're going to have moving forward as a state is going to scale them from pilots, and scale them from a house here and there to something to wide. So a couple more, just two more slides. We're looking at the different state agencies, and we've got this, and also give us a perspective on kind of cost government initiatives. And there's three things that we think that make a lot of sense that we can kind of do in the immediate term. The first is to integrate resilience criteria into the Louisiana's capitalized cost of choice. And every agency is seeing physical impacts from disasters. So one place to begin is systematically ensure that the state investments and facilities perform as they're expected and they last as long as they're supposed to, is beside them designed with environmental risk management. So that's an idea that we've seen Florida started that in 2020. New York, New Jersey created time resilience design guidelines. North Carolina just issued an executive order to get this, and even in conversation with DOA about doing this, and so we get that story and start talking about that. Another one we talked with them about a little bit is moving towards an enhanced hazard mitigation. So there's a process involved in this. It has to go through and see what it looks like. But we definitely want to reinforce this idea of cross-agency collaboration network towards holistic resilience, because it requires holistic mitigation programs and it's most steps, but the mitigation return is 20%. There's some financial benefits to the state that could come from this process. And then the last one is just kind of recognizing that there's a change going on in the federal government from a disaster recovery stance to more of a pre-disaster mitigation and resilience focus. So we've got to be just to be more aligned and more ready to kind of meet that change. How can we make sure we're working together so that we're able to leverage all the different programs that are available in this disaster context to kind of move the state forward in any direction? So I think that's a big thing we want to keep our mind together. And so, lastly, just kind of take a long view where we're going to be headed down the road. Let's get this shift to this kind of new initiative in the second term. We're working as we can. Obviously, we need this work in a coastal context. Like I said, I think in the CPRA master plan maps, we have really good data about how this is going to change in the future. But we also know that there are other types of climate impacts that we're going to face in the state, and they're not going to just exist. And so that the extreme heat, drought, record seas, freezes, heat modifier, it's not something that we're not particularly familiar with in Louisiana. So, we have new data sources coming online all the time. We've got to make resilience and adaptation something that we're doing constantly all the time. Last two, you know, obviously state agencies are not the only people being affected by these challenges, or the only ones that can benefit from this kind of holistic approach to resilience planning and better processes to adapt to future conditions. And so we really wish we could have worked with the local government all along these past 2 years. We just don't have, you know, time and day and people and all those kinds of things, but that's kind of our first big goal. And there are others too, like utilities, private sector entities that are all part of this mix about how we come back stronger after disasters and then just work prepared for disasters in the future. And then finally, just dedicated resources, expertise, coordination, and leadership are essential. That's what we have. It's kind of the CPRA formation story all over again. And it has to be some of his job to make his priority. It has to be some of his job to get a lot of 10-foot money. It has to be. We need to unify the approach, right? We can't all be asking for different things all the time. That's kind of a lesson that kind of created Chip's position in the first place. And so I just want to end by just kind of saying that capacity, you know, is the thing that's really kind of holding us back. So that's something we talk to state agency folks all along. They're dedicated to accomplish this first step and getting this progress towards that. But for most, almost everyone that was involved in this process with us, this was some additional duty on top of their other group. So I just want to again thank all the resilience coordinators that kind of work with us in terms of this effort, and that's the last thing I have, so I'll have to take your questions.
All right,
Charles, thank you very much. I'm going to go through a question.
Thank you, Charles. That was a great presentation. It was a pleasure to have you in our talents and crises.
All of them.
You know, I imagine you're speaking, this is an initiative
want to mention, the resilience effort group involved in COMESA is a huge federal revenue sharing thing that they're working on, lifting the cap, getting some more revenues there, but we're involved. But, you know, as we adapt to the climate, we need to adapt to our own climate.
You're right.
And do the other thing in the task force that they cost. Right? So, when we build a project that is meant to create resilience and protect citizens and protect fisheries, we need to continue to look at those projects and make sure that there are no unintended consequences down the line. So, and there's going to be, Mr. Chairman, there's a specific project. He said, in fact, she has a gift here from our coastal director. Box full of rocks here, so that probably says it all. So, but seriously, all these projects that we do today may have to be altered or refigured in the future. And we need to keep that in mind as we implement this adaptive action.
Signal here at box with a beautiful ribbon with a card that says to Chip from St. Bernard Parish. It's a box full of rocks. So the rocks have been taken down from Mr. Go, and I want to hear a little more about it. All right, so Charles, thanks for the update. Good work. Look forward to future updates. Do we have any public comments from the audience?
Thank you.
you will join us.